Hey guys, we're just doing our a quick video on the new Hearthstone cards. The last video that we did kind of got janky, so we're just
a little janky.
Gonna do it again. This one's gonna be a lot faster. We're just gonna kind of go through the cards, summarize them, and talk about the first wing that we've had a chance to play through, and the effect that some of those cards have had on the game so far. Tim, go ahead and lead off the charge for the card list.
We're gonna be doing this by class breakdown new, and sure. Starting out with the druid.
The druid.
Big push to get beast cards in the druid deck, starting with goblins and gnomes, which at the time seemed kind of weird, but now that all these beast cards coming out for the druid, it's actually kind of becoming viable. But the first one up is a jungle moonkin. It is a 4-cost 4/4, and it gives both players spell damage +2. I think we both agree that this card is not something we're going to be playing.
Yeah, I don't see it having much use in Constructed. I think that was the bottom line, with the consensus we kind of came to with this card.
Like, it's nice that it's a beast, but that spell damage could really fuck you over.
Yeah, like I said, it kind of depends on how it's played. We've talked about a few situations where it could be viable. For instance, you need to throw that down and then swipe or something to get that extra 2 damage for board clear. That might be viable, but that's an 8-mana combo right there, so that's really not viable until late game. There's so many different slots that this card can take up that just, you know, it's not as viable as others in Constructed, so I don't think it's going to get a hell of a lot of play at all.
No.
But we'll see what happens with it.
It'll be a goofy arena card, I think.
Yeah, I think so too.
A lot of these cards seem to be goofy. Arena cards, not so good and constructed. But moving on to the second druid card, Mounted Raptor. Now, this is a cool one. It is a 3-cost 3/2, but its Death Rattle summons a random 1-cost minion, effectively making it a cheaper, not as good Death Shredder.
Yeah.
And it has the beast tag, so beast synergy there. Real good stuff.
I've seen some talk on both sides for this one. There are some people that are saying that it's better. Then the other card, what is it?
A piloted shredder. That's
piloted shredder, yeah, that's it. Some people are saying that it's better because it's faster. It's basically got I don't know that it's better personally, but I've also seen some people saying that it's worse. So I don't know. It kind of depends on whether or not you need to figure it out. Either way, it's certainly a good druid card. I can see this getting a pretty considerable amount of play, especially since it's wearing the beast tag. Unfortunately, I think this card would be a hell of a lot better if it said, like, also summon a beast, you know, summon a random 1-cost beast or something like that. I think it would be a little bit better, but we've seen a little bit of it in the wings that we've played. The genie likes to throw that on this card a lot, especially in heroic. So it's interesting. Playing against it hasn't been too much of a problem, but I think it's definitely viable. I'm just certainly going to be playing around with it.
Yeah, I like this card. This is something I can see fucking around with and constructed.
Mm-hmm. So next up we have the Raven Idol. It's 1 mana. It's a spell. And it is choose one, either discover a minion or discover a spell. I think that this card is interesting.
It's not awful.
It's certainly not bad, but once again, it comes down to the fact that this card is going to take up a slot in a deck, and there are many other much better cards that can go in its place. It's certainly interesting.
It can be potential to be awful, it can be potential to be great.
Exactly. It's relying on the RNG.
Yeah. And you're right. It absolutely, you know, there's 30 cards in your deck. You don't. Maybe one is a goof, but yeah, I don't see running two of these.
Yeah, not at all.
If you're trying to do some type of spell slinging, like druid thing, mm-hmm. for whatever reason, but yeah, this. I wouldn't say it's as bad as a jungle moonkin, but it's definitely not going to see as much play as the mounted raptor, I think.
Yeah, I agree with you there. So moving on to the hunter class, what's the first one we have, Tim?
The Explorer's Hat, which we're both kind of, about this one. It's a spell for 2-cost, and the effect is give a minion +1/+1, and the Death Rattle, add an Explorer's Hat to your hand. So, essentially, you can keep playing this card over and over and over.
Mm-hmm.
problem is it's a 2-cost 1/1 buff. And it's like it's potentially something your opponent could even steal with like a Shadow Priest or something like that. Shadow Priest. I think this card has the potential to be fucking hilarious. I don't know if I would really run it though, especially in something. I don't know. For a Hunter deck,
I think Hunter needs to be much faster than what this card allows. They need to rely on creatures that give buffs as like battle cries rather than trying to have two dedicated mana for a buff. I've heard some interesting things saying that this would help counter mill decks. That's true, but you have to rely on it getting destroyed regularly for it to reappear back in your deck. I guess it just gets added to your hand, so wouldn't even counter the mill deck thing. I don't remember where the hell I read that, actually. Reddit, I think.
Somewhere. Probably, yeah, let's blame the Reddits. They suck.
I agree. It's 2 mana for a 1/1 buff. Not worth it. I think there's plenty of other things to use.
Moving on to the Desert Camel, another Hunter card. It is a 3-cost 2/4, and the battle cry is to put a 1-cost minion from both you and your opponent's deck onto the battlefield. Kind of neutral on this. Could be potentially great for a face hunter or something like that if you could just pull like a leper gnome.
I think this card is fantastic if you're playing against non-aggro decks. If you're an aggro deck playing against a non-aggro deck, it just helps you more because of the fact that it is a specific one-cost minion.
Right.
If your opponent doesn't have a one-cost minion in their deck, then they don't play anything.
And you just get
the bonus. So there's a lot of potential here. It's sticky with the 4 health, and 2 damage isn't greatest, but it's got a beast tag, so it can get buffed by stuff like Houndmaster, there's plenty of stuff that hunters have that can buff beasts. So it goes well. You also, I think I might be wrong. Let me double check that before I say it.
And just with the 2/4 stat line, there's a good chance this will be able to clear out a 3-drop and live. Just because of that 4 health. Like, early game, that's pretty decent stat line. Especially dropping, right. Like, coining this out on turn 2. Also getting another minion in addition to it.
The other cool thing is that this can be summoned by Ram. And so can Mounted Raptor, by the way. If you're a hunter, you can have a chance to
Got the beast tag. I don't know, would the battle cry trigger on the camel if you summoned it like that though?
No, but it's a great sticky card for dealing with like other aggro things. Like
it's better than drawing like a 1/1 or something. Mm-hmm. Which, you know.
So it's not a bad one to get. The 4 health for 3 mana, decent stats. I think it's worth it. I can definitely see that card getting a pretty significant amount of play in aggro hunter decks. So next up we've got Dart Trap. It's 2 mana. It's a spell. It is a secret. When an opposing hero power is used, deal 5 damage to a random enemy. So I think we talked about this. When we talked about this, we were saying that it's got potential to be great. It's got potential to suck.
Right.
The problem with this card is because of the RNG, it's not reliable enough for aggro decks. And it could be viable, I guess, if the meta slows down. And it's already starting to. I've noticed in the couple of ranked play matches that I've played lately, it's been not bad. It's been a lot slower. I actually played one deck. One game earlier today. It was I was playing a control shaman, and I was up against some sort of mage. I don't know what so it was just. Anyways, it was almost a 25-minute round.
That sounds awful.
That was an experience. If things are slowing down, I guess. And if it slows down enough, then I can see that being a viable option. But if you're trying to play aggro hunter, I don't think that's going to work at all.
No. on the idea of getting 2 or 5 face damage for 2 mana is great, but just yeah, just RNGness.
Just have to make sure, yeah, you have to make sure it hits the face. That's all.
Anyway, so that's the 100 cards. Moving on to Mage, animated armor. It's a 4-cost 4/4, and this card's gimmick is your hero can only take 1 damage at a time. Don't know. Pretty neutral on this, honestly. That's an awesome ability, but this thing only has 4 health.
I think this card is a card that sounds absolutely amazing until you really think about it.
Yeah, until like, or even you just try to theorycraft with it and like play with it,
yeah.
And it dies to like a Shadow Bolt or just something of that ilk, well, even if you have a Taunt Wall up.
Yeah, it's ridiculously easy to remove from the board if you're playing. The problem is that this has pretty. I mean, it's 4 mana for a 4/4, but it's stat-wise, it's just not reliable enough to stay on the board. I mean, yeah, it can't immediately get removed by some removal cards, mainly a priest that I'm looking at. But there's so much that mages, I mean, even warriors can get this pretty easily off the board if they've got the right weapon and stuff. So I mean, it's just not that great. It's going to be one of those things that you can throw down and you can cross your fingers. Maybe if you can put it behind a taunt wall or something, then it might be worth it. But even if you're playing like against another mage, it's vulnerable to flame strike. I mean, it's vulnerable to all sorts of stuff.
Every class is a card that low to mid cost card that can get rid of this in one turn.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like it's one of those things. Like I said, it looks like it's going to be awesome, and then you think about it, and it's really not that great. It's kind of a wasted card.
I guess maybe if you buff it up, but you're a mage, so how's that going to work?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, I don't know how you go about doing that, but that's a mage. But
thoughts? No, it's a priest.
But yeah, the next card we've got is 5 mana. It's called Ethereal Conjurer. It's a 6/3. It's battle cries to discover a spell.
Not a fan of this for the cost.
Awful.
Yeah, it's too much.
I think it's. I think your cost. If you really desperately want to draw cards, or I guess, I don't know. You can think about discover being basically a form of card draw, but you have no idea what you're going to get. So it could be something. Could be something really awesome. It could be something awful that won't help you at all. So you're paying 5 mana for something that's not guaranteed when you could play like Arcane Intellect or something like that and draw 2 cards from a deck that you built and know what they're going to be, or at least an idea of what they're going to be rather than just, and you know, that costs 3 mana. Granted, you're not getting a card on the board, but the 6/3 stats, dude, like,
yeah, the 3 health is just
anything, and it's kind of pointless for it to be there. Because of the fact that it's 6 damage, you know, it's easily destroyed by a priest, and it's threatening enough for an opponent not to want to leave it on the board.
I wouldn't even waste a Shadow Word Death on that thing, honestly, at 3 health. Like, even as a priest, there's so many easier ways to get rid of that thing. Just
yeah, I'm just saying that it just makes it more vulnerable to stuff
right.
Like that, you know? You know, if it was like a 4/3 for 4 mana or something like that, then even that would be better. But yeah, I think that card's kind of pointless, which
yeah.
Is unfortunate, because that really is like two cards that I think are pretty much useless for Mage. But they kind of make up for the next one, which is Forgotten Torch. It's another spell. It's 3 mana. And deal 3 damage, shuffle a Roaring Torch into your deck that deals 6 damage. So, something we learned today is that the Roaring Torch itself still only costs 3 mana. So, you're paying 3 mana for, you know, 1 spell that does 3 damage, in addition to gaining another spell in your deck at some point that's going to do 6 damage, for also 3 mana, which is pretty damn good. It's an interesting card. I really wish Blizzard would design more cards like this, because it's still got the RNG factor of the fact that, you know, it's shuffled into your deck, you still have to draw it at some point. But it's guaranteed. You know what you're going. You, eventually, somewhere down the road, you will get this card in your hand. And
it's 6 damage for 3 mana.
Yeah, it's 6 damage. You have guaranteed 6 damage. So really, what you can look at this card as being is six mana for nine damage. That's pretty damn good when you consider a Pyroblast is 10 damage for 10 mana. That's pretty good.
Yeah, it's a great card. When we initially did this, we didn't know how much the mana cost would be for the Roaring Torch. But yeah, three mana for six damage. That's fantastic. And anti-mill, because we know how prominent those are in the meta.
Yeah.
But there's that to it, too.
So we've got the Paladin cards next. Tim, what do we have?
Oh, my goodness! We have Anything Can Happen. 10 mana. Summon 7 Murlocs that died this game. Holy shit, Snacks. This card is amazing.
Yeah, dude, absolutely the best.
Because Murlocs die a lot. I don't know. I don't really think my Murloc deck, like, even when I win, I don't make it to turn 10. But if you do, and you're still alive, that has the potential to be fucking awesome.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I see Murloc decks becoming something that is getting closer and closer to being viable. But I feel like this card is for the wrong class. I feel like this would have been so much better if it was for Shaman.
Shaman got some Murloc love. We'll get
there. Yeah, they did, but I feel like this card right here would be perfect in a Murloc Shaman deck.
I think this is really to play off of Murloc Knight and just all the shit you summon off it that dies immediately.
Yeah, that's true.
But again, in Murloc decks, you good chance you're not going to make it to turn 10, win or lose. So don't really know how viable this is, but it's a hilarious card I will absolutely run.
It is a total... I don't see it like ever getting played aside from Shits and Giggles.
I mean, why else would you play a Murloc deck, Palmer?
As of right now, yeah, I guess it really is only for Shits and Giggles. So.
I hope Murloc decks are always for Shits and Giggles. That's the way it should be.
So yeah, interesting card. I think there's a lot of people that are upset that this is taking up a slot for a Paladin card as one of the new cards that are coming out. But considering how fucking powerful Paladin is right now, I'm kind of glad they wasted a card like this on them.
Yeah, I can get behind that too.
So what do we have next?
Keeper of Ulduman.
Ulduman.
Ulduman. It is a 4-cost 3/4, and its battle cry is to set a minion's attack and health to 3. It's kind of like a higher cost, little bit tougher Peacekeeper. Except it also switches, instead of switching your attack to 1, it switches both the health and attack to 3. I think this will be great against bigger creatures. Like, Dragons, Nefarian, Dr. Boom. Like, it sets something, you can take a big creature and set its health line at 3, and then hopefully kill it with something. Even the...
But why not use that same logic with something like a quality? Or like,
yeah, but I mean,
Paladins have that reduced,
yeah, no, yeah,
health to 1.
No, you're absolutely right. I just think it's a decent creature, honestly. Like, I mean, 3/4/4 is kind of terrible, but just the fact that you could just completely neuter a big legendary, I guess it's not as solid as Peacekeeper, but a Peacekeeper also doesn't do anything to the health, it just changes their attack to 1, so this just brings it down. And then you could drop a hammer on something and just kill it that turn. Granted, that'd be, a 7-cost turn. But you could kill a big minion and then still have a 3/4 on the board, which is kind of annoying. It's not horrifying, but it's not something you get rid of terribly easily.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's true. I don't see this getting a lot of play at all.
Yeah, it's very situational.
So I don't know about this card getting a lot of play. I don't know. We'll see. I'm kind of on the fence with this one. I am leaning more towards the side that this card is actually just going to be awful. But we'll see what happens with it. I don't know.
I don't think it'll replace Peacekeeper, but I think there will be some hilarity combos with this card in play that you'll see.
Yeah, maybe. We'll see. Next up, we have a card that I
just what Paladins needed.
I just don't understand. Why? Anyways, it's 1 mana. It's called Sacred Trial. It's a secret. When your opponent has at least 3 minions and plays another, destroy it.
Rip Zoo decks.
Yeah.
except not really, but
I,
you know.
I just like, I don't understand why Paladins need this card. I think it's a really good card. It will effectively neuter tempo and keep aggro at bay. It's just another card that can help Paladins reach turn 6 and play that mysterious challenger. But that's what they got. That's what they got. They got another card that is an awesome secret. Good for
another
you.
Secret,
well,
yeah.
Well played. Balanced game. Moving on to the priests. These cards, the three cards in the priest class are probably three of the ones that I am most excited about out of this series. The first one's 5 mana. It's a spell. It's called Excavated Evil, and it's deal 3 damage to all minions. Shuffle this card into your opponent's deck. Now, shuffle this card into your opponent's deck. Why on earth would you want a card that does this?
Anti-post-strats, what's wrong
what
with
what is going on here? Well, let me tell you, sirs, it is because, and madams, I guess, it is because of the fact that it doesn't matter if you don't have creatures. Play a pure control deck. Play a pure control priest deck. I'm very excited about that becoming a thing again.
And even just priests, a lot of priest cards are just big creatures where 3 damage, they can shrug it off. So.
Yeah, yeah. So focus more on stealing your opponent's creatures, or just have creatures that are big enough to not be destroyed by 3 damage. Either way, that's a pretty good option for priests. I think this card is going to be overlooked by a lot of people, but only temporarily before the potential of this comes out. The only thing that is a downside about this card is that it relies on a very slow meta in order for it to be any sort of successful. We'll see what happens, I guess. I mean, the other interesting thing about this is as soon as your opponent plays it, it just comes right back into your deck. So it's something that has the potential to just be played back and forth endlessly, unless it gets like counterspelled or something. But other than that, I can see that being a lot of fun. A lot of fun, and I like the potential that it has.
Great for aggro decks, goes without saying.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It just helps control priests live that much, a little bit longer, and in the hopes to be able to seize the board and control the board even more. So finally we have, the next card, rather. Not finally.
Getting ahead of yourself, Palmer.
Yeah, apparently. It is called Entomb. It is a 6 mana spell, and it's choose an enemy minion, shuffle it into your deck. This is interesting. I'm not sure how to feel about this.
I don't know if it, like, does it remove it from play and shuffle it into your deck, or do you
no,
just shuffle it?
Well, see, that's the thing. I'm not sure. It could mean that it makes a copy of it and then shuffles it into your deck, or it could mean that the creature comes off the board and then is shuffled into
I feel
your
like
deck.
If it was a copy, it would say shuffle a copy of it into your deck. Because some
I don't know, man. There's some weird language on Hearthstone cards that doesn't make a lot of sense sometimes. Have you seen Disguised Toast video on inconsistency with wording in Hearthstone cards?
No, but I play Hearthstone, and I'm aware of some inconsistencies and just bad wording.
So we'll see. Yeah, well, this is an example of it. We'll see what it actually means. I do like the potential that this card has. I think the two drastically different outcomes that we just discussed, whether or not it removes the creature from the board, is another thing that's going to dictate how good this card is.
I think with that 6 mana cost, it play and shuffles it into your deck.
You'd hope.
Oh yeah, I feel like that'd be fair with a 6 mana cost.
So
it's a lot of mana.
We'll see. Also, a very good card for control priests. So maybe that's where Blizzard is leaning.
Dragon priest or bust.
And then finally we have 2 mana 1/2 called Museum Curator. It's a battle cry. Discover a death rattle card. Interesting. I think that's also for the wrong class.
Yeah. Not a bad card, though.
Yeah, it's not. It's certainly not a bad card at all.
It's something to keep your hand full while you play. Although with priests, that's not really an issue, so.
That's another card that I would absolutely love to fucking see in a shaman deck. But
I feel like you're leaning towards Shaman, Palmer. Why could that be?
I wonder. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how to feel about this either way. I'll explore some death rattle options, I guess, and see what I can do with it. But still, like I said, I think there are three of the most interesting cards that are being released with this.
Adventure.
Yeah, adventure. So next we're moving on to the rogues. The rogues have three cards that are all pretty fucking awful.
I like the second one, personally, but we'll get to that.
Yeah, so we've got Tomb Pillager. It's 4 mana for 5/4. It's Death Rattle is add a coin to your hand. It's interesting. I do like the fact that it's a 5/4 for 4 mana. That's pretty damn good. Wish it was a 4/5. That would be a little bit better.
Yeah, I think I'd take that. A Yeti with a free coin, that'd be cool.
Yeah, exactly. That would be pretty sweet. I don't know what it's going to be like with that. I guess it's nice that you get a free coin. If you play it on turn 4, then you know turn 5 you're going to have 6 mana. And you can maybe try to get some sort of tempo advantage. Or something.
It's good for combos, too, but...
Yeah, that's true. It will give you more combo potential. I didn't even think about that.
It's a big thing with rogues. I don't know if you knew that, but you know, they tend to like the combo.
I don't play a lot of rogues.
No one plays a lot of rogue anymore, Palmer.
That's true. So I don't know. Has some potential. Tim, what's the next one? You said you like this one.
I do. It is titled Unearthed Raptor. It is a 3-cost 3/4, and its battle cry is to choose a friendly minion and get a copy of that Death Rattle effect. I just think this has the potential for hilarity. It's absolutely something I would run in Constructed just because of the potential of hilarity. Granted, you'd kind of, you know, you're going to have to put some Death Rattle stuff in there to get some synergy working with this thing. But a 3-cost 3/4 is not awful. And if you can copy even like a Leper Gnome or just some goofy Death Rattle effect, I think it gets value. But that, of course, means you're going to have a Death Rattle. Not only are you going to need a Death Rattle minion, but you're going to need to have it on the board when you play this thing.
Yeah.
But I like it. It's goofy. It's fun. It's an unearthed raptor. It's a skeleton raptor. Just
yeah,
yelling.
There's a few interesting things that like could come out of this. There's what is it? There's a rogue card. Was it Feign Death? Cue all death rattles or whatever.
Is that, yeah,
no, that's a hunter card, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know, man. It would a very situational card. You're right. 3 mana for 3/4 isn't the worst thing on the face of the earth, but.
And also with rogues, like, you're not really... Death Rattle isn't at the forefront of your mind. It's more about combinating with stuff.
Which
and
is,
battle cries and, like, you know, SI agents and shit. You don't...
Which is why I think that might be more of an...
Yeah, it would be much better suited for other classes. Or even as new... If this is a neutral card, it'd be fucking awesome. But,
yeah.
I'm kind of with you in the fact that it's... Because it's rogue, it suffers from it, so...
Yeah, absolutely. What else we have?
Pit Snake is the last rogue card. It is a 1-cost 2/1, and it has the poison effect, meaning any minion damaged by this minion dies.
Well.
But it's at 1 health.
I mean, as long as it survives long enough to attack, it's all you care
yeah,
about.
Like, this hasn't made its way into the meta because it's not actually out yet. But we play in the Hearthstone wing you played against, I did notice... I kept fucking running 2 or 3-cost minions into a fucking 1-cost pit snake because of the poison effect, and I didn't want it to kill something bigger, so I'd run a 2 or 3-drop into it. So I guess it has the potential to be cool, but it's just at that 1 health, it's just so easy to... If you're a mage, it's just dead. If you're a druid, it's just dead.
Or if you're a rogue, it's just dead.
Yeah, it's just, there's so many just basic hero powers that can kill it. You don't even need spells, so... I don't know, but it is a 1-cost card, so... And it's got the beast energy, but it's a rogue deck, so what the fuck are you going to do with beast energy?
Yeah. The way that I look at it is it's kind of more of a thing that nerfs stuff like Ram Wrangler. Because if one of those pops out from Ram Wrangler, like, honestly, it's just... It's going to be awful if your Ram Wrangler summons.
5 mana, 3/3, you get a pit snake? Yeah, I'd be a bit fucking annoyed.
Yeah. So, you know, it nerfs a handful of cards, and I don't know. It's interesting, I guess. See what happens.
But no. Going on to Palmer's class of choice.
Yeah, man, the Shaman,
pick
man.
Pick up on that. Shaman.
So the first card is 7 mana. It is a spell. It is called Everything is Awesome.
Ah, oh, so good.
Everything is cool when you're part of a team.
Yeah. That's what happens when everything is awesome. Fuck, I fucked it up. I'm gonna kill myself. I'm can't. Let's do it.
So it's give your minions +2/+2, and it costs one less for each Murloc you control. This card could be interesting in Shaman Murloc decks. Go figure. Now, if only there was another previously mentioned Paladin card to go along with this card, Tim.
Nah,
you know,
need Murloc Knight bonuses, boys.
Beautiful. I don't know. The card's pretty good. The problem with it is, obviously, if you're not running a Murloc deck, it's not
kind of bad.
Good. Yeah, it's pretty awful, actually, if you're not running a Murloc deck. And it's very dependent on you having Murlocs on the board. So either you're already going to have board control and tempo, and the game's probably yours anyways, and this is just kind of icing on the cake.
Yeah.
Or you're just not going to be able to play it because you're losing. So
Murlocs are just so hard to kill unless you get the buffs off one another that, like, yeah, like, I don't... It's really hard to see a situation where you have a board full of Murlocs and this is the thing that turns the tide, because you're right, you're already winning, like... Just fucking.
Now the thing to note about this is that it is a permanent buff. So let's say you have 3 Murloc or 4 Murlocs out on the board on like turn 3, which is entirely possible. And you draw this card, all of a sudden this is a 3 cost card, and the 4 creatures that you have on the board are just gonna wreck house because it's a permanent buff. That's really the only thing, like I said, but that's probably a situation where you're already gonna be winning if you've got that much tempo early game. You're already kind of winning it, so it's good. It's got potential. I am definitely going to experiment with this card.
You'll experiment with any shaman card.
That's true. So we'll see what happens. Next is Rumbling Elemental. It's 4 mana for 2/6. After you play a battle cry minion, deal 2 damage to a random enemy.
I like this.
This card is pretty good. It's not a bad one-off card for a Shaman Murloc deck, because Murlocs have Battlecry left and right.
Even regular Shaman cards, like the Elementals, have Battlecries. Like, just an this is a great card for pretty much any Shaman deck, honestly.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff to play off with Battlecry. So, got a lot of potential, I think. And I think it could help maintain mid-game for people that are trying to play Murloc decks.
That 6 health stat line is very nice for 4 mana.
It is. It certainly is. So it's extra sticky. And you know you're it's one of those things where either this is going to stay on the board and help you maintain board control because you're playing so much Battlecry stuff, or this is just going to be something that your opponent throws a whole bunch of stuff at and buys you time for a turn. And at 4 mana, that's not a bad thing. Like, there are cards out there that are much worse than this that cost a lot more. That would achieve similar things, but I think this one does it pretty successfully. And then the final one is a 1 mana 1/3. It is called Tunnel Trog. It's whenever you overload, gain +1 attack per locked mana crystal. This card is interesting. This is another card that I'm certainly going to be experimenting with because I already play a lot of overload.
I think this is great for overload decks. Like,
I've been trying to make overload something viable for a really long time. and I've had mixed results. Most of the decks that I've got usually only achieve probably about a 45% win rate when I try to do serious overload decks. They are very fucking fun to play when you're winning and horrible to play when you're losing.
I think this is a great one drop for overload decks because you can bust out early lightning bolts and shit just to kind of keep control of the board, and you're constantly buffing this thing.
Well,
granted,
it says, the other great thing is, like, well, I guess it's whenever you... I need to see how this interacts with things, because of the language. If I play, like, say, like, you play Elemental Destruction, which gives you 5 locked mana crystals, and then throw this down on the board, will I gain the 5 damage?
No, like, this has to be in play.
Well, then it can't be in play with the best overload.
Well, no, yeah, like the giant 4 or 5, but I'm talking just lightning bolts, Lightning Storms, kind of 1 to 3 cost cards early
Yeah,
game.
you'd
This
have to
is
like
great.
you'd have to like stack them though in that case. Like stack, like throw that down and then play a shitload of overload cards.
Not necessarily. Even just turn one, play this. Turn two, throw a lightning bolt out to kill the minion your guy dropped. All of a sudden, this is a 2/3.
That's
And
true.
It stays that way. It's not just for that turn. It stays. It's only got 3 health. That's kind of where it kind of starts. It'll start to fall off mid game. But for a 1 cost card, I think this is fucking great. I would absolutely run this if I were you, playing a goddamn overload deck like a memester. I think this is a great card for that.
Yeah, we'll see how much potential it has. I'm definitely going to experiment around with it. So now we're moving on to the Warlock. Tim, what do we have with the Warlock?
I really like this card. I was thinking about this earlier today. It is a first Warlock card. It is a 1-cost 1/1 called a Reliquary Seeker. But its battle cry is if you have 6 other minions, gain 4/4. Now, right off the bat, 6 minions on the board, that's not necessarily going to be a rare occurrence. But it occurred to me, you throw an implosion at, you got 2 minions on the board. You throw an implosion out, suddenly you got 6 minions on the board. You got 3 minions on the board, you throw an implosion out. My point is, you can fill the board up with shitty 1/1 imps with an implosion, then drop this, and all of a sudden it's a 1-cost 5/5. That is fucking awesome. Like, I can't wait to fuck around with this thing.
Baron Rivendare plus Death Horses plus this.
That would be pretty ridiculous.
Could you imagine if you just had that perfect hand where you had like a Baron Rivendare, you throw that down, throw down a Death Horsey, throw down 2 Sacrificial Packs, bam, you instantly have 4 Death Horseys, and then you throw this down and it's a 5/5.
I think you don't even do that. You just concede because you know you beat Hearthstone.
And then
you concede
just,
and you never
and then you
play
just
again.
Spam greetings over.
Well, mess. I don't know why I'm doing the paladin guy for the warlock, but yeah, that's what he would say. He would just well met him to death.
Greetings.
Greetings.
So yeah,
but yeah,
I
really
I think
like the card.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
You're right. Implosion. It's situational, unfortunately, but it's also one of those things where if you're playing a Zoo deck successfully and you've already got that massive board control and that tempo, this only secures the win for you.
And it's only a 1-cost card, so it's not unfeasible to like put an implosion and then follow it up with this. Because
yeah, no, not at all. It would totally work. The next thing we have is a 2-mana spell. It's called Curse of Rafum. Rafum!
Rahim!
Rahim. Give your opponent a cursed card. When they hold it, they take 2 damage on their turn. So, this card is interesting. I haven't played around with it yet. I don't know what a cursed card looks like or what it does.
I did it in the adventure. I did a Thought Steal and stole this, and he just never played the cursed card. Just kept doing 2 damage, but it would make sense that you would be able to play a cursed card to kind of get rid of it off your hand. And
okay,
you know,
would it be if you couldn't get rid of it?
If you could, that would be fucking stupid, and this card would get all the play in the world.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I don't know what the curse card is. That's really going to be... Well, that's exactly what we said last week. Depending on exactly what the mechanics are of the curse card, this card could either be really cool or awful. So, we'll see what happens, I guess.
They take the 2 damage right at the beginning of their turn.
Yeah,
so
regardless, they're going to take 2 damage from it. Yeah. But in that case, the synergy between it, 2 damage for 2 mana, is not that good.
Yeah.
There's better stuff out there, but I don't know. We'll have to wait and see on that one.
Please.
Next one we've got is Dark Peddler. It's 2 mana for a 2/2 Battlecry. Discover a 1-cost card. Okay.
Yeah, it's not an awful turn 3 play because it's something you can immediately plop down.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. It's not awful.
Not particularly good. Not particularly bad.
I can see that maybe getting more arena play than constructed.
Yeah.
But you never
know. It doesn't have a demon tag. It doesn't have any kind of real synergy. It's just you get a 1-cost card.
Right.
So.
Moving on to the warrior. What do we have first?
Warrior says, first warrior card is a weapon. It is a 1-cost 2 damage with 3 durability. But its effect is double all damage done to your hero.
So I messed around with this a little bit in the class challenge, the warrior class challenge.
Yeah.
I don't think it's worth it. I played that class challenge multiple times, not because it was difficult, it was really fucking easy, but I played it just to like check out the other cards and everything.
Right.
Yeah,
I think that if it was too durability, where it's something you could get rid of real quick, I think it might be feasible. But just the fact that it's got three durability, it's going to hang in your hand for three turns. Like,
well, I just don't see it replacing. I don't see it replacing Fiery Axe like at all.
Which is a two cost. The attack with two durability. Yeah,
which you know will get because basically you want to clear. The only reason you'd be playing this is to get rid of early stuff on the board. There's no way in hell you
do double damage,
and then swing at something big with something like this. That'd be silly.
Super silly.
Unless you're going for like top kick, fucking BMs, and just that you kill yourself by playing this card and then swinging into the face of a fucking I don't know Nefarian or something.
This card is now viable. I'm playing.
You're just sitting there at 16 health. And you have no way of winning, so you just suicide by dropping this and swinging to a Nefarian and taking 16 damage.
All spamming greetings.
Greetings. Over and over again, yeah. I don't see the point in it. I don't understand why it's rare, and honestly, I think it's a pretty awful card.
Not a fan either.
Next card is Obsidian Destroyer. At the end of your turn, summon a 1/1 Scarab with Taunt. This card is going to be awesome in Arena. I don't think that this is going to be viable anywhere else.
And it's a 7 cost, 7/7. You get a point. It's kind of like a shittier Dr. Boom in a way.
Yeah, kind of.
I like it. I think for a Control Warrior, it would be halfway decent. I might try to... I don't have any Warrior cards, but if I did have Warrior cards, I might fuck around with it. But
Well, I'm gonna experiment with a Taunt Warrior deck using bolsters and some other stuff that came out of TGT. Because I think there's some serious potential for a legit Taunt Warrior deck. Throw like a Hogger in there and like a few other things to generate Taunt minions and then just bolster over and over again. I think that could be pretty sweet.
Could be interesting.
And it would synergize really well with the next card, which is called Fierce Monkey, which is 3 mana for a 3/4 with Taunt.
And it's a beast for the Warrior class.
Yeah, it's interesting. Because it's got the beast tag, it's going to be summonable by a whole bunch of shit. So we're going to see a bunch of classes getting this card periodically. And since it's also a 3-drop card, it has a chance to trigger with... Oh no, the Shredder's only 2 mana. Awesome, or is it 3?
Shredder? It's 4, isn't it? Yeah, it's 4 for a 3/4.
It's 4/3. 4 for a 4/3, but like,
right.
It summons a 2 mana cost mini or what?
Yes, 2.
2 mana, okay. I don't know, there's potential with it. I think it'll be good in that Taunt deck that I'm thinking about
the
trying
dream
to build up, seeing how viable something like that is. It's not a bad card. It's decent. I think the only one that's really good for the Warriors coming out of this set is Obsidian Destroyer, which is kind of disappointing because... Aside from Control Warrior, Warrior just doesn't... Since they got rid of Patron Warrior, and I'm not complaining about that in any way, shape, or form, but...
Beat you if you did.
Since they got rid of it, that's... Control Warrior is about the only option Warriors have anymore. So it'd be interesting to see some other stuff come out of Warrior decks. What do we want to cover from the neutral stuff, Tim? You want to go through all of them, or you want to just do legendaries? What do you want to do?
Oh, let's just blitz through them. We'll start with the legendaries first. We'll just keep doing what we're doing.
Okay.
First one is a 9-cost 7/8 by the name of Archthief Raphim. Raphim! And his battle cry is to discover a powerful artifact. And these artifacts are as follows. Lantern of Power, which is a 10-cost. Give a minion 10/10. So... Buff the shit out of a minion, but it's 10 cost. All these cards are 10 cost. The next one is Mirror of Doom, which fills your board with 3/3 mummy zombies, which I find that fucking hilarious. I love that card. I want to play that. It seems hilarious. Last one is a Timepiece of Horror, which deals 10 damage randomly split among all enemies, kind of like an Avenging Wrath, but with 10 damage. Mm. But you have to keep in mind, all these cards cost 10, so it's your entire fucking turn. Late game.
Yeah.
But these are pretty awesome cards. I mean, you can buff a minion 10/10, fill your board with 3/3s if you have an empty board, that's a big deal. But AoE can kind of fuck with that. Or just the giant Avenging Wrath. Yeah, I don't know. It's 9 mana for a 7/8 stat line. It's not good at all, but it gives you another card out of it and legendary boys. So I like it, but I don't know necessarily if I'm going to play it.
Yeah, I'm with you on that.
Moving on, we have Reno Jackson, which has seen a lot of love because it was the first legendary released with the wing. It is a 6-cost...
I'm surprised how much viability there's been with this so far.
I've seen some hilarious shit with this card.
Yeah. Like,
it's great. It's a 6-cost 4/6, and its battle cry is if your deck contains no more than one of any card, you fully heal your hero. That's hilarious.
Yeah.
There's a video going around of a guy playing this with not a Shadow Priest. The priest card that turns your healing into damage, and he plays this card and he just instantly kills himself.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
But yeah, you can. Potential to just utterly kill you.
That's funny.
But, I mean, if you're an idiot. But yeah, this is an interesting card. I like this. For Constructed, it definitely changes things up a bit. Because it's a neutral card, you can play it with any character. So you just got to think of how I want to build a deck with, you know, a lot of the characters have cards you want to have two copies of in your fucking deck. So it changes things up a little bit. It makes Constructed more interesting and it potential hilarity in Arena. Although, I guess as you're building Arena, you're seeing your deck, so you can purposely like hope that you get Reno Jackson and, you know, not put any copies of anything in your deck. But I don't know. I like it. It's fun. The 4/6 stat line for 6 isn't amazing, but it's not terrible. It's a good mid-game card.
Yeah, it's certainly not awful. I've seen... did you see the tournament play with this card? A Freeze Mage put it in their deck. And it was, like, totally fucking viable, and it worked really, really well. I think he, like, won the tournament because he had Reno Jackson in there.
Freeze Mage is known for taking a pounding from time to time, so...
So, I think, like, he got it and then just, like, counted off the cards. He made sure he played one of every card before he played it, and then...
Yeah, that's another thing. You can put doubles in your deck. If you get it in your hand, you gotta hold on to it and know that you've played all the doubles you have.
Yeah, exactly. It's interesting. I think there's going to be a lot of potential with this with Control Warrior, too. So be on the lookout for something like that.
Yeah, I could see that working in a Control Warrior deck. All right, we're going to move on to... LZ Starseeker? LZ? I don't know how to say that.
Elise.
Is that really... Oh, goddamn. Many ways to spell that name, apparently. Anyway... Its battle cry is to shuffle a map to the Golden Monkey in your deck. Map to the Golden Monkey is a 2-cost card that when you play it, it shuffles the Golden Monkey into your deck. The Golden Monkey is a 4-cost 6/6 with taunt, and its battle cry is to replace your deck and hand with legendary minions.
Sure is.
That is a fucking card, boys.
It is.
It's just it has the potential to be hilarious, honestly. The first, like, you have to go through 3 steps to get a Golden Monkey out, but the first of the 4-cost 3/5, not bad. Like, that's a pretty good mid-game card. You can get rid of some stuff with that and potentially keep it alive a round or two. The second part of it, where you just pay 2 mana and all it does is shuffle the Golden Monkey into your deck, that's not very great. But if you are doing this, I think at that point in the game, you've gone through a good amount of your deck. Maybe you're down to 15 cards. Better chance that you'll actually pull the Golden Monkey, but then again, you might have 15 cards in your deck still, so you might not ever see that fucking thing. But just replacing your hand and deck with legendary minions is hilarious. And the Golden Monkey is a 6/6 with taunt, so if you are near death and you play it, there's a chance that it'll keep you alive in the next round where you can just drop a stupid amount of creatures or whatever and take the game back. But
maybe.
I don't know. Are you thinking about running this card at all? These series of cards?
I am definitely going to for shits and giggles. Yes,
this is a shits and giggles card without doubt.
This is the definition of a shits and giggles card. I think it's interesting. I think the fact that it takes 2 turns at a minimum for this to trigger the way it's supposed to makes it pretty awful.
And that's never going to happen. You're never going to get this off in like 2 turns. Anti-mill, Palmer. What do?
Yeah, exactly. it's interesting.
It is interesting. I'll give you that. I'll accept it. Acceptable. The next legendary minion is a 3-cost, 2/4 by the name of Bran Bronzebeard, and your battle cries trigger twice. Potential hilarity could ensue.
With this and Elise, you get 2 golden monkeys.
What is this? Just replace your deck, you get all a handful of awesome legendary minions, then it replaces it again, you get a handful of shitty legendary minions.
Yep.
Just nothing but Nat Peggle.
Yep.
How rustled will your Jimmies be?
Well, you know, pretty rustled, I guess.
But a 3-cost, 2/4 is not awful. It has the chance. It has a decent chance to live to turn 4 if you play it on turn 3. Or especially live to turn 3 if you play it on turn 2 with the coin.
This is definitely going to get played in the Shaman Battlecry deck that I'm going to build.
Yeah, good synergy with the other Battlecry stuff. Yeah.
So, I mean, like I said, I see a lot of potential with that. I think it'll be a really fun card. It's basically the Baron Rivendare of Battlecry.
Yeah.
The one thing that I don't like about it is I wish it was stickier. I would rather it was just 1 damage and 7
like
health.
5 or 6 health, yeah.
Like Baron Rivendare is. Honestly, I'd rather it be 5 mana and be a 4/7 or something like that. That would be the most preferable option, I think.
I like it at 3 mana. It's potential for Murloc decks. You throw down a Tidebringer or whatever, and you get an extra Murloc out of it. Or just there's a lot of mid-game battle cries that I think could benefit from this. Especially if you play it later in the game, you can immediately trigger it.
What is the name of that Shaman card that summons, like, 6 Murlocs?
Oh, the Legendary? I can't remember. It's like a 7/7, 7 cost, 7/7, memory serves.
Yeah, Neptalon. Yeah, that's it. So I mean, I think it could be really good in a Murloc deck too, like you were saying, because that would automatically add eight fucking random Murlocs to your hand if you had that in play while you played a Neptalon.
Yourself to death.
It's totally fucking possible to play both of those cards at the same time for 10 mana in one turn, and all of a sudden just throw down a bajillion Murlocs the next turn. And then just turn around and play fucking, what is it?
The 2/2 buff.
Awesome. And then you just win the game, and it's just like, that is the dream. That is the ultimate dream.
I think as you're executing that combo, your opponent just concedes, though.
Yeah, probably.
Just crushes your dream and laughs.
But it'll be fun. I think Bronzebeard, out of all of these cards that we've read off so far, that one will probably see the most play. Out of everything legendary-wise in this deck.
I think it's a toss-up between him and Reno Jackson.
We're ending the legendary list with...
the ultimate legendary.
With Sir Finley Myrtleton.
Myrtleton!
Myrtleton! It's 1 mana for a 1/3, which is pretty fucking good. Battlecry, discover a new basic hero power.
He's got the Murloc tag. You got to add that in because that's a big thing.
Oh yeah, he is also a Murloc. It's interesting. How legit would it be if you're playing like Murloc Shaman and you just throw this down and then all of a sudden you aren't summoning totems anymore? You're pinging things for 1 damage.
I'm really looking forward to trying this out in my Paladin Murloc deck just because I don't need to summon 1/1s. I've already got Murlocs, so it'd be kind of cool to. You know, get a fucking fireball ability or a druid ability or something. So,
I don't know. That's one of those things that could be really great or like genuinely awful, depending on what kind of hero power you get and how the game's going. Next we've got the Ginny of Zephyrs. It's 5 mana for a 4/6. Whenever you cast a spell on another friendly minion, cast a copy of it on this one. This one sounds fucking awesome for priests.
It sounds awesome for this control warrior, dude. You bolster your taunt minions, all of a sudden this gets 2/2. Like, this is a great card.
Well, the reason I think it's it would be really good for priests is because of what is it, inner fire and all that stuff. Say you're buffing up a light warden, and all of a sudden this thing gets the same buffs like the inner fire and all that stuff. That has massive potential. All of a sudden you have two huge creatures on the board that are very, very fucking threatening very, very quickly. So I think this card is definitely going to go hand in hand. And God forbid you have like a fucking baseless manipulator or something like that in your hand too. Like this is the this card right here. I think this card is going to go places for priest play. I expect to see this a lot.
I expect to see this in lots of decks, not just priests. Yeah. Like this is a great card.
Next on we've got Naga Sea Witch. It's 5 mana for a 5/5. Your cards cost 5. This is kind of like a double-edged sword. I guess it'd be cool if you were running this in like a druid deck.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say.
Like late game stuff.
A lot of big creatures that are suddenly 5 mana, that'd be pretty cool.
What the hell is the name of that druid card that gives you like 10 mana right off the bat, discard your hand?
Ancestral something or other.
Yeah, something like that. You play that and then follow it up with this, and then every single card that you're getting from there on is just 5 mana to play. Like, that's pretty good. It's very situational, though. If you're going to build a deck that revolves around that, you're going to have to make sure you mulligan for that fucking card.
And you got to keep in mind, it's a 5/5, but it's a 5/5. Like, it's not impossible to get rid of, so.
Yeah, I mean, you could just ramp up your druid, I guess, and play that. And it's very, very, very good potential, but whether or not you're going to be able to pull it off the way that it needs to get pulled off reliably is another question entirely. Next up, we've got Summoning Stone. It's 5 mana for 0/6. Whenever you cast a spell, summon a random minion of the same cost. This card is garbage.
I don't know, I kind of like it. It's like that 1 week's Tavern Brawl, but like encompassed in a card that you can build.
I like the card. I like the idea behind the card, but it's never going to see play. There's no fucking way, dude. Like,
yeah, it's a neutral card. Throwing it in like a priest deck or something where you got a lot of 0 or 1 cost buffs.
The only way that I can see this really getting a lot of play is if the meta slows down enough. I'm just like, judging from the meta's perspective right now, you can't afford to throw down a 5-cost 0/6 creature. You can't,
a real spill heavy mage. Like, I could see this card working, not necessarily well, but I could see it working.
Yeah, I guess if you're doing like a control mage or something like
that. You'd have to do something real spell heavy. And it's not necessarily a card you build a deck around, but it's something you'd have to keep in mind when building said deck. But it's not great, but I don't think it's awful. I think it has the potential to do some cool stuff.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's pretty awful, personally. But
we're going to have to agree to disagree, Palmer.
Yeah, I guess so.
I guess so.
Next up, we have Eerie Statue. It's 4 mana for 7/7. Can't attack unless it's the only minion on the battlefield.
It's like an amazing Ancient Watcher, but it has the possibility to attack.
Yeah.
So I like this.
It's interesting. I think that this card will be very good for decks that don't have a lot of creature reliability. I think the interesting with this set that a lot of people really aren't catching on to is the fact that Blizzard is trying to implement some way for a lot of classes to rely more, not necessarily solely on spells, but more on spells than on creatures. And in doing so, they're kind of getting rid of the whole idea of maybe board control and focusing more on just controlling every aspect of the player. So it's an interesting card. I think it'll work great with decks that don't have a lot of creatures in them.
And just a 4-cost 7/7 that you could, you know, throw a Sun Protector or a Defender of Argus on. That's pretty great.
Yeah, exactly. Next up, we've got Ancient Shade. It's 4 mana for a 7/4 Battlecry. Shuffle an Ancient Curse into your deck to deal 7 damage to you when you draw. This card, I think it would be a lot better if this was a 7/7 as well. Considering you're taking 7 damage from it at some point, the 7/4, I just don't think it makes it worth it. If it
had
charge or something like that, then it'd be something entirely different. But 4 mana for a 7/4, you're going to take 4 damage guaranteed, or 7 damage guaranteed at some point during the game, and it may not have the ability to last on the board long enough to make it worth it.
I mean, I could see it being something in the aspect of a Arcane Golem, Like you drop this down on turn 5, and then you, what's the 4/4 buff for the Warlock? I can't remember the title of it.
The one that instantly kills things?
Yeah, where it no, the 4/4 buff that kills it at the end of the turn, suddenly turning this into a 11/8. Just kind of rushing in for face. I think it has the potential there. But yeah, just knowing that if it's not something you're going to end the game on real quick, that it's you're going to draw it and take 7 damage, I don't think it's I don't think it's a terribly good card. But it would be good for like a quick ending game type thing. Because it's very unlikely you would draw that 7 damage on your next turn. But it has 4 health, so it can die pretty easily. So,
right.
I don't think it's a great card.
Yeah, I don't think it's a very good card either. We'll see what comes out of it. Fossilized Devil Sore. It's 8 mana for an 8/8 battle cry. If you control a beast, gain taunt. Basically, this is a terrible fucking card. There is already an 8 mana 8/8 that automatically gets taunt. It is a druid card. It is called Iron Bark Protector. This is a worse version of Iron Bark Protector.
I don't know. It's something you could run in a hunter deck, like a hunter beast deck or something, because, you know, hunters don't really have a whole lot of higher end cards. I don't think it's awful, but I don't think it's great.
I think this card is trash.
Like, trash?
Genuine trash.
Well, I do say.
This is the wrong side of the tracks. This card is not wanted. Go home. You're drunk. That's
the fact that it's a neutral card is the only thing, the only saving grace for me. The fact that I can throw this in a couple of different weird decks. But yeah, there are cards that are better. It's an 8 cost for 8/8 that might not get. Even if you're running a beast deck, there's no guarantee you'll have a beast down. So yeah, it's not terribly great. But I mean, it could have the potential to be great, or not even great. It has the potential to be okay, I guess. So yeah.
I guess. Next we've got Wobbling Runts. It's 6 mana for 2/6. Death Rattle, summon 3 2/2 runts. Alright, so this is basically coming down between a choice of playing this or, what is it, Savannah Hyman. Like, if you're a hunter, they both are very similar, but the Savannah Hyman has higher stats and attack damage.
And the beast synergy, so.
Yeah.
This has no synergy with that type of shit.
So, I think this card is actually pretty good. But only if you have a way to make this a threatening creature. I just think the 6 mana for 2/6 is a little low, even though you're still getting three cards afterwards. I don't know. This could be something that could be interesting in like a Warlock deck, with the card that we were just talking about that neither of us can remember the name of right now. The +4/+4 destroyed at the end of the turn.
Oh, the yeah, that. It's been a long day. But yeah, I guess it has a potential for that. Yeah, it's such a low stat point for 6 mana.
Right,
like,
which is
at that point in the game, you're not going to be able to really kill much with it. So.
Well, I don't know. I mean, like, it's like that's why I was saying, like, if you can turn around and figure out a way to buff this creature and then immediately destroy it.
I don't know. You'd like have to play. Like, yeah, I don't know, Priest Inner Fire, Druid buff. Like, I guess there's different ways you could buff it, yeah.
What the hell's the name of that fucking Warlock card? God damn it. 1 mana +4/+4.
The Requillary Seeker.
No. The Warlock spell, dude.
Oh, Christ, yeah. The one I couldn't remember. Yeah, I don't know. But yeah, it absolutely has potential with that. Because you're, even if you're not killing it with something, it's going to die and give you 3 2/2s. At the end of the turn.
That power overwhelming.
Power overwhelming. How do we forget that? We're such idiots.
I don't know, dude.
Do we even Hearthstone? Do we even
exactly.
Pay to win?
So yeah, with something like power overwhelming, I could see this being viable in a Warlock deck.
Yeah, that'd be great.
But the other thing is, like, at that point, paying 6 mana and then summoning 3 2/2 runts, yeah, that's pretty good, but 2/2's really going to matter that much at that point?
At that late in the game, yeah.
Which is why I would rather see it like be like 2/3/3s or something like that. I would rather it be that almost at that point, but we'll see. I mean, we'll see how it's played, I guess. Next we've got Anubisath, I guess, Sentinel, how you pronounce that.
Sure.
5 mana for a 4/4 death rattle, give a random friendly minion +3/+3. At first glance, I thought this card was pretty bad. And then I thought about it, and I think this card has a lot of arena potential. I also think that watching what the bots have done with this card is pretty interesting. I think it's the whole, like, you know, the fact that it's a neutral card, so it can be played in anything, gives you a 4/4 creature, and then if it dies, you know, assuming it doesn't get silenced, it gives something else +3/+3, is going to be something that might be...
It's something your opponent has underrated. To play around.
Yeah, it's going to be underrated when it comes out on the board. I think we're going to see a little more play of this card than people are giving it credit for. Time will tell. Could you think of any like potential combos or anything like that that I'm not like thinking of off the top of my head? I don't know.
No, just it's a 3/3 buff is a pretty big deal.
It's just something that gets thrown on the board and you have to be aware of its presence.
Yeah.
Let's see here. We've got Gorilla Bot A3. Battlecry.
A-3.
A battlecry, if you control another mech, discover a mech. It's 4 mana for a 3/4.
And it's a mech.
And it has the mech tag. I think this is a good card.
Yes, very much so.
Because, simply because of the fact that you can discover literally any other mech.
Yeah, and it's a mech, and it's just, yo, dog, I heard you like mechs. So you put a mech on the field, you draw a mech, you play another. It's just, I like it
yeah,
a lot.
So
good
mech
synergy.
It's good for mech decks. Yeah, very good mech synergy. Great thing to have the tag for. Next thing we've got is Tomb Spider. It's 4 mana for a 3/3. Battlecry, discover a beast. It is basically the beast version of the Gorilla Bot. But
and it's got the beast tag.
It has one stat less.
I like it.
Just
because it has the beast tag, and you discover another beast, yeah. You just keep the beast stuff going so that you can drop out the Wrangler or whatever.
Beasting it up, man. Just
beasting it up.
Beasting everywhere.
I approve of this card.
Next, we've got Jeweled Scarab. It's 2 mana for a 1/1 Battlecry. Discover a 3-cost card. Not bad.
Pretty also has card. The beast synergy.
Beast synergy. It's going to be shitty for Ram Wrangler now.
Yeah. That would
piss some people off, right?
I'd be like, man, I could have gotten a fucking pit snake. God damn it.
Yeah, exactly. Suddenly you're wishing you got that fucking pit snake, right? It's a mediocre card. I don't know. I don't think it'll ever see any play.
I like the beast synergy, but I don't necessarily. I'm going to play the Tomb Spider over this without question.
Yeah, exactly. Next, we've got a huge toad. It's 2 mana for a 3/2 death rattle. Deal 1 damage to a random enemy.
And beast. Last beast card.
It's an interesting card. It's basically a worse version of that. Whatever the fuck the
priest card?
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
It's basically a worse version of that, but...
It's a 3/2 as opposed to the other card being a 2/3, so...
Right, and you're relying on death metal, so rattle, so this thing has to die before that trigger comes into effect. Either way...
With that 2 health palmer, I assure you it will die.
It's not a bad deck. It's definitely going to be good if you're on an aggro versus aggro situation. Then this card will shine wholeheartedly, I think. Other than that, I don't know. It's kind of up in the air whether or not this...
I don't mind it. It's a 2-cost 3/2 with the beast synergy, so... Not bad. Could be worse, could be better.
Finally, we have the best card.
The greatest card ever.
The best card in the entire set. It's Murloc Tiny Fin. It's 0 mana for a 1/1. It nerfs the shit out of Murloc Knight, because this thing is suddenly summonable by a Murloc Knight.
That would be pretty... honestly, there are already 1/1s you can get out of a Murloc Knight, so...
Yeah, well, imagine getting this one. Pretty much the worst.
I would be so happy, Palmer. I'd be so happy. It's a wisp with a Murloc tag, basically.
Yeah, pretty much. So it's got the Murloc tag on there. It's an interesting card. It makes Murloc decks a little faster if you really want to run these. It's like 2 separate slots.
Yeah, if you get a War Leader out or like you drop the 3 health buff Murloc on this, like it's not awful. It's not like playing a wisp.
Yeah, it's not. So, I mean, it's got that Murloc tag, which is the only real saving grace for it. Otherwise, it's just a pretty generic shit card that's just going to take up space, I guess, if you really desperately
want to. Wisp, please.
Other than that, we've hit about everything.
We've hit everything. Quick summary of the first wing of the adventure. What did you think, Palmer?
Pretty good. I liked it. Definitely dug the last boss. The last boss, the whole escaping thing, I guess, if you
yes.
really want to call it a boss, was a lot of fun, very unique. I thought the previous 2 boss battles before that were also very well done. I particularly like the Genie. The Genie on Heroic has been giving me a serious run for my fucking
He took me a couple tries to get through, which was surprising because the wing itself, in comparison to the other wings, is actually pretty goddamn easy. So I was like, oh, I'll just fucking Heroic it mode, no problem.
Yeah,
and then
yeah.
Took me a couple tries, but yeah.
Yeah, I haven't gotten him yet. I'm still working on him.
Scrub.
Well, you know.
Scrub it then.
If only Fallout hadn't come out, I wouldn't be playing a shitload of Hearthstone, not Fallout. But yeah, I mean, other than that, it's pretty good. Looking forward to what this week has in store for us.
I'm liking this adventure. I liked all the other adventures. Like I do. That's the one thing I like about Hearthstone and Blizzard in general is these adventures. I hate when they put out these giant expansions when I'm never even going to collect the fucking basic set of cards or the classic set of cards. But these adventures, it's not just about getting these cards without having to dump shitloads of cash. It's playing through the AI, which I like. I mean, I don't play AI anymore, just, you know, practice mode. But I like getting these adventures and having a reason to play through AI because they give you, like, with this wing in particular, these new challenges and, like, the way the game plays is different for different bosses or different wings. So, yeah, I'm really digging this. The cards, I think, are the weak point of this adventure, but just the adventures themselves and playing through them, I'm enjoying this much more than I did Naxxramas or Blackrock.
I'm basically looking at this set as like the Urzas of Hearthstone, pretty much. This is kind of like back when they released like Urza's Saga and Urza's Legacy in Magic, when they were releasing cards that just seemed like they were just the most random fucking things on the face of the earth, and then all of a sudden people realized that there were these crazy fucking possible synergies. I think that's what this set is going to turn into, especially once they start whenever the next one gets released. I think whatever's in here is going to start to really shine.
Yeah, I can see that.
Because it really does seem like they are wholeheartedly trying to slow this game down as much as not as much as they can, but make it so it's more viable for mid and late game decks to exist reliably. And get rid of just the aggro nonsense there is. I think they're just trying. Blizzard is realizing its mistake and is now so slowly implementing stuff in the game to make it so it slows things down.
It's not uncommon in the current meta to know if you're going to win or lose a game by turn four.
Yeah, turn four, yeah.
Yeah.
You kind of have an idea unless something drastic changes or your opponent fucks up big time. Like, if they've already gained tempo, your chances are that's it. Like, that's just the way it's going to be. Which is not necessarily fun or interactive.
It's Hearthstone. No one said this would be fun.
But yeah, I don't know. I'm holding out a lot of hope for this expansion. I guarantee you, once it's completely out, there will be things that we haven't thought of that people are going to start realizing. It's going to change.
Yeah.
Be prepared in the near future to see a lot more Control Priest. I am just like warning everybody now, because back in the day when Control Priests were totally a fucking viable option, everybody complained about them, and then they sped everything up.
And now everyone wants everything to slow down.
Vicious
cycle.
Absolutely vicious cycle. I'm just saying, people be prepared. Control Priests are coming. They're coming back, and I'm going to be playing one of them. Anyways, I think that about wraps up the episode. Tim, was there anything else you wanted to add?
No. Some decent cards, some shitty cards, some fun adventures to be had. But yeah, all in all, I think we're both in agreement that this is a good thing for Hearthstone. It's a fun adventure. It adds some cards, and like you said, it has the potential to really add some interesting stuff down the line with the next expansion or adventure.
Absolutely. Well, on that note, I think we'll wrap it up here. This has been the Hearthstone special, the makeup for the makeup episode of the Hearthstone special.
What he said is truth.
Take care, everybody. Have a great evening.